Hi everyone. I hope you can all hear me.
We can
Amazing.
hear you, but can't see you.
Bear with a second.
We can't see you.
Bear with a second and I will be with you. It is just loading and then we will get started. But whilst that gets loading, I just want to say welcome everyone. It's an absolute pleasure to welcome you to tonight's event. I hope that you're all in the right room and you're all here for the right reason to have our inaugural event for Black History Month with Xavier Baker in conversation with Marvin Rees, who is our mayor for Bristol. So it's an absolute pleasure to welcome you to UWE Bristol. I'm Louise Gouviet, and I'll be your host for part of this evening. I'm the Staff Engagement Officer within the Equality, Diversity and Inclusivity team. Black History Month has been marked in calendars in the UK since 1987, yet sadly, the world hasn't radically changed since then. This is why events like today are so important, and the conversation around race and equity needs to be loud, visible, and spearheaded with systematic change. The racism and discrimination that we have seen over the summer and beyond demonstrates that we as a global community need to not just raise awareness, but act urgently. Here at UWE Bristol, we know that we have more work to do, and we are committed to ensuring that everyone who studies and works here is able to be themselves, bring their diverse identities into the UWE community, and experience welcome, belonging, and an environment that enables us all to give our very best and access opportunities equally. Just for ease, if everyone could have microphones off apart during the event, because then it'll help in terms of to avoid any background noises happening. We are very pleased to kind of be offering you this talk, Xavier in conversation with Marvin Rees, as part of our series of events to celebrate Black History Month. During the course of this evening, we will be discussing the history of Bristol and the slave trade, the story of the Colston statue, and how it made waves around the world. Thank you all for taking the time to being with us today. We hope that today will bring you will bring you stimulating conversations, but most importantly, that you will continue these discussions beyond the time that we have all together. In terms of kind of all the technical sides, my colleague Fiona Hamilton will be providing tech support as the moderator of the event, and my colleague Jamie Darwin will be supporting the live tweeting over on at UWE Equality. You can find us on Twitter. Please do tag us in your conversations about the events and follow Marvin Rees on Twitter, which is Marvin J. Rees, Xavier Baker, Xav Baker, and use the hashtag BHM to kind of make sure that we can kind of get that this conversation beyond this virtual room. So in terms of the tech side things and housekeeping of today, we don't expect to have any fire today or any of those things, so that is good. But please do make sure that you keep microphones off and video off for the duration of this time. If you need us in terms of any moderator, you can post in the chat like you've been doing and we'll respond to you and answer any queries, or you can send private messages to the moderators and we'll be able to respond directly if you don't want to post in the main feed. We will be taking questions at the end of the event, but we would like to ask you to hold all your questions till at the end. There's a specific section as part of the event that is for questions, and we will be using a platform called menti.com, and that will just help us to be able to manage the questions coming in and being able to answer them effectively. So yes, yeah, so please do hold all your questions that you may have for the mayor for that time of the event. But obviously, if there's anything urgent, then don't hesitate to get in touch with us directly before then. So it's my great pleasure to welcome, we are very lucky to have both Professor Paul Illuminati and Professor Steve West in the event today. Steve, would you like to go first? And then Paul Illuminati, can you go next for a welcome?
Great, thank you very, very much. I hope you can all hear me, and I'm delighted to be here. And of course, to welcome Marvin, and to say a big thank you to Xavier for doing what I hope will be a really stimulating start to Black History Month. And of course, my hope is the same as yours, that really this shouldn't just be about a month. This should be something that we are engaging with throughout the entire year. And I think if we are to learn from the lessons that we've seen around us over the world over the past few months, it is that inclusion and how we treat each other and how we learn with each other and how we create opportunity with each other for each other is the way that we're going to be able to move forward as a society and navigate the challenges that the world continues to present for us. And of course, those challenges are the things that we need to turn into opportunities. So I'm really pleased to be here. Thank you very much, Marvin, for spending the time. I know that your diary is probably worse than mine, and I'm really thankful for the time and effort and energy that you put into supporting the university, but actually for the tremendous work that you do right across the city, region and beyond. You are an inspiration, and it's great that you're able to spend some time with us this evening. So that's really all I wanted to say. I'm really proud that we're able to launch in such a dynamic way. And I absolutely want to ensure that we continue this conversation. And of course, for Bristol, we've got so much to learn and so much to do that I know with the energy of the people in this room this evening, we will be able to make progress and ensure that in the end, we create a society and an environment that we can all be proud of. So thank you very much. And I'm going to hand straight over to Paul, who really is the person that should be doing all the introductions and the welcomes. So thank you for just giving me a very quick opportunity. Thank you.
Paul, are you able to turn your microphone on, please?
Okay. Yeah, okay. My microphone was off. Okay. Oh, again, I want to just follow on the where Steve left, which is that Marvin is our mayor and a true inspiration to every person in the city of Bristol. It is a great privilege to welcome Marvin here tonight to help us launch the Black History Month at UW Bristol. What a privilege for me to welcome the first Black mayor in Europe who is connecting the whole world together. He just didn't say I'm the mayor of Bristol, But what he did was to bring all mayors across the world together last year to the city of Bristol to celebrate our history and to dictate the pace at a world stage. What is a connecting world together? What a privilege to welcome a complete human being who believes and passionately drive oneness for all humanity and the sharing of human kindness beyond color, beyond gender, beyond sex, and beyond privilege boundaries. Marvin is clothed with intelligence and astuteness. And when I hear him being grilled by journalists and the way he's able to respond to them, it brings so much pride in us with his intelligence and astuteness. Challenged, but strong, unwavering and steadfast in his principles. We are very proud of you, sir, and that our city, the city of Bristol, did not keep quiet in the face of tyranny and did not sit to tolerate a symbol that depresses Black people across the city, attest to your leadership. You are a shining, transforming light and an inspiration to our students and staff. And we want to tell you tonight that you in Bristol love you, and we welcome you here tonight. You in Bristol is proud of our heritage of providing university education and taking university education to where it has never been before. 35% of our students this year are from working home backgrounds and from what is described as low participation neighborhoods, which can easily be affected by what is described as mutant algorithms across the city. UA Bristol is doing something about this, and we sponsor the Cabot Learning Federation of 21 schools across Bristol, and our schools are improving yearly with our students and staff connected with the schools in the Cabot Learning Federation and beyond. In the process of doing this, we know that our students are being transformed. Our dream for them is that they become that inclusive individual who are not, you know, repressed and then they stay there, but who are able to stand and be like you, sir. In the process of doing this, when they are with us, there are many challenges, and we do recognize of racism, of sheer lack of money, of oppression, and feeling not included as they should. We know this. We recognize this bane on the human society and are determined as a university to do the best for our students, to make our university environment the most inclusive environment of all universities for every race, without creed or gender, without discrimination of any kind. We have an award-winning equity program that is encouraging Black and ethnic minority students and encouraging them with their careers, with mentorship. And we bring speakers here who help to inspire them. We are starting a speak out policy, which will make them more confident for them to be able to identify whatever is bothering them, especially racism, for them to come out and be what they can. Our aim is to transform our students and for them to become transformers. You are this inspiration that is underscoring this, our desire. We want them to be like you. And we are all listening to you tonight. And we know that we are going to have a great Black History Month as you help us launch it tonight. We have one of our ex-students, Xavier, who will be moderating the event tonight. So you are very welcome, our mayor, and we love you, and you are welcome to UWE Bristol. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul. And Steve, and it's an absolute pleasure and a real honour, and it kind of shows the importance of race equity here at UB Bristol to have two of the top senior members of staff taking the time to be part of this event. So I just want to say again, thank you so much for your commitment and to equality, diversity and inclusivity. I will now be passing on to Xavier Baker, who will be hosting the next section of our event for the In Conversation with Marvin Rees.
Hello, everyone, and thank you, Professor Paul and Professor Steve, for such a warm welcome. Marvin, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Great.
Can you hear me? So I'm just to say, I, as you talk about my diary, I really appreciate that. I'm just in transit. I will have my camera on in an extra 5 minutes.
That's fine. No problem. I think, yeah, no problem at all. Yeah, just as we start, I just kind of just to echo the fact that today's the launch of Black History Month, the start of Black History Month. And today's also the first day. Nigerian Independence Day. So shout out to any Nigerians who are watching today. And so we've got 45 minutes. So and before we kind of get into the juicy topics, I wanted to start things off by helping the audience to get to know you a bit better, Marvin. I hope that's okay.
Yeah, sure.
Great. So this year has been particularly difficult and potentially traumatic for Black people the world over. How have you been, firstly, and secondly, how have you been looking after your mental health and your well-being?
Yeah, fine. I think it has been disturbing for some people, but to be honest, many of the things that people are coming, I think it's probably more disturbing for people who think that the world that's being revealed now wasn't there. So I, you know, as if I think for say white Americans, so forth, who don't necessarily come into contact with shootings, it will be disturbing for them to find out their country is not what it was. For people who think that actually through the inevitable progress of time that we'd gone beyond race, finding out that race was still an issue determining life chances, even to the point of death, it will be disturbing for them. But actually, for many people who have essentially lived on the underbelly of the world, for want of a better way of putting it, this year has, I would suggest, has not been as destabilizing as all that, because they knew this was the case. So I suppose I haven't found it that destabilizing. What it has done is brought a greater sense of urgency to the world around me and more challenges, particularly with COVID.
Definitely. I think it's kind of just been a loaded year, kind of, yeah, like you're saying, so it's kind of just pulled that curtain away and made things even more obvious that as conversations about race have kind of surfaced. Before we get into that, I wanted to ask you a little bit about your own journey and the fact that you grew up in Bristol. So how would you describe the journey you've made from being raised in a working class environment in Bristol to becoming the city's first Black elected mayor?
Look, I don't want to overclaim, but I think the data would say that I shouldn't be the mayor of Bristol today, or I shouldn't have gone to university. I was born in 1972, just to age me. Those of you do your bit of social history, my mum was a young white woman then, unmarried, from a poor background, with a brown baby on the way in 1972. And before I was born, she tells me that health professionals were pressuring her to have an abortion because it wasn't the done thing to be unmarried with a brown baby in 1972. When I was born, a number of people were telling her if she was a good woman, she'd put me up for adoption. And now those themes then carried their way on through my early years. We lived in a refuge for a year before coming back to the Long Cross Estate in Lawrence Weston, and then moving to Easton, where I then lived since the late 70s until I went off to Swansea University. So my childhood, I'd say, was, I had a loving family, but it wasn't a childhood I necessarily found happy. because of the poverty and my sense of vulnerability. But I'm black, I'm mixed race. In the 70s, we had two big riots or rebellions in the city, and I had to navigate that as well. I mean, Bristol was a city in which it was not unusual to have people shout at you from their car, "Oh, you're a wog," or "you're a coon," or other such words I won't mention on here. That was normal 1980s experience in Bristol. And so we had to navigate all that. So I say it was challenging, but I had some good people around me. I had a great boxing club, a great teacher intervened. Like I said, we had a council house, so I had a stable home. And that gave me a platform for actually trying to do something.
That's really interesting. You touched on the fact that people, that racism could have been, at that period, was quite overt. And I think that's the big difference between now and then, is that racism does exist. It's as you mentioned, that curtain that has been pulled away this year. But I came to Bristol 5 years ago, moved from Southeast London, and I was kind of under this impression, I hadn't really seen overt racism before, and I thought, well, racism doesn't really exist anymore. And actually, I came to UM, came to university, met a real range of people from loads of different backgrounds, and saw that elsewhere in the country, people were bringing those racist views and stereotypes with them. That was the baggage they were carrying with them to university, unfortunately. In terms of your political career, some kind of moving past your university experience, was there a specific moment or event or interaction that kickstarted your political career for you?
No, I mean, it was a journey, but there were particular moments that obviously accelerated, or which I, you know, chapters changed in my life. So I'd grown up watching my mum disrespected, experience racism and other things, and seeing, from an early age, I could see that some of my friends in school weren't being treated with the same level of respect and optimism in their life. And that burned inside me. In fact, I did say I had my RE teacher. I went to a secondary school, which is now City Academy. It was St. George back then. And there were three lower schools, and they were all in the process of merging. So two of them merged first. Mine, which is called Rose Green, and one called Redfield. And they would tend to be working class schools. So they were black, Asian, and the poorest white people. Right. So they merged first. And the other school, Park, was up at which is up at St. George's Park. They were tended to be white kids who, I'm going to put my camera on, who paid for their school. They paid for their school meals. That's how we made the distinction. Did you have free school dinners or not? Now, in my RE class, there was a teacher that used to say to us every week in class, "You wait till those kids from Park get down here. None of you are going to be in a top class." She'd say this to us every week, Miss Magnuson. In fact, there's a professor at UWE who also basically jettisoned me from his computer science class. and I met him when I was a reporter at Radio Bristol. He had no vision for me. And he was friendly when I went to interview him, but in school he was a nightmare. So I had that burning inside me. So I had an interest in politics. I went to university. I managed to get in. I studied politics and economics because I thought, right, that would give me an understanding. I had sworn off of anything that I thought was establishment. I thought politics was corrupting and could not be saved. So I did a master's in Black American politics, and I went straight to work for a development agency. And I just thought, I'm going to be an activist. I'm going to be one of those people railing into the system from the outside. You went to the US, worked for several civil rights campaigners, came back, became a BBC journalist. But in 2000, I met Simon Woolley from Operation Black Vote. And Simon said to me, "Well, you've got a great system of rubbish, but what are you actually going to do about it?" And actually, continually why the world is rubbish without putting any solutions on the table is something that frustrates me now, but I used to do it. And that was a real pick up the bar.
It's like, Marv, you've got to do something. You can't just keep telling people the world is unjust. What's the solution? And these are the accelerators. Coming into mayoralty was basically that the mayoralty, Bristol went for a mayor and someone said I should go for it. I see there's a note saying the sound is off, so let me just go nearer to my Wi-Fi, that might help.
Cool. Thanks.
Can you still hear me?
Yeah, we can still hear you.
Okay. You can carry on, Xavier. Sorry, I'm moving about.
Okay, that's fine, that's fine. That's all right. There was a lot there. You just to unpack a little bit of that, and bring it into the university context. You touched on the fact that you went to Yale, obviously one of the best educational institutions in the world. How do we kind of grow that pipeline? How do we make sure that there's more people following your footsteps and the progress that we're making kind of becomes faster? Oh, we have lost some army, and I can see the comments. It's coming back.
Okay, have you got me back?
Yeah, we got you back. Sorry, we lost you there. Yeah, sorry. I'll just repeat the question. So I was just kind of picking up on the fact that you mentioned that you studied a master's in America, and given that this is a university event, I just wanted to kind of for you to touch on on that experience of studying in America, and also maybe touch on how we get more young Black people to be taking advantage of and accessing scholarships and programs, like the leadership program that you took part in, and then also you went on to develop.
So I went to I'm just changing my device to see if it gives me a better connection. I studied in America twice. I first went to a university called Eastern, which was a small university just outside Philadelphia, and then I went to Yale University for the Wards Fellows Program in 2010. I think one of the things that was particularly interesting about being at Yale with a number of Black academics. And I tell you, one of the first events I attended at Yale was in the African American House. And I think, is that better?
A lot better, yeah.
Oh, great, okay. Let me use the iPad then, because that sounds like it'd be better. And so I went to this event at the African American House, and I was in a room of about 40 Black students at Yale University. And I thought, this is incredible. I've never been in an environment like that. And we were actually debating, the debate was Black defined. The question is, what does it mean to be Black? And a really, really kind of interesting debate. But the number of Black academics at Yale University was one, and the diversity of the student body was one of the things that really, really took me, really international university.
Yeah, unfortunately, now as a member of staff for UA, I can say that there aren't as many Black academics as we would like here, and that there are some issues around staff retention here, and that feeds in with the Black attainment gap, the BAME attainment gap, and the Black attainment gaps at universities. So there's a lot of progress to be made, but in terms of having that kind of network of other Black students. Or other students of colour, I think the equity program, I hope you would have heard of it before, that was founded by one of my role models and mentors, Dr. Zainab Khan, and I was lucky enough to be asked to be one of the chairs of the student committee. But that's where I really found that final kind of comfort and solace as a student, being able to kind of share and be coached and talk about leadership with my peers. That was a really fantastic opportunity. So I really hope that equity keeps going strong in the future.
Well, one thing, let me just say something about that, what you've experienced there. Something I've noticed at Yale, and actually I've linked up with Steve on this in Bristol in the past. So when I arrived at Yale, they said to us, I was on a cohort. It's something called the World Fellows Program. Mm-hmm. Now, interestingly, there were 15 of us. They take 15 people each year from around the world, and you go there. I never thought they'd take me, and they did, right? So my next door neighbor, interestingly, was Alexei Navalny, who's just been poisoned, right, by Putin. So I know Alexei, so I respect him. Lumumba Diaping, who was the lead climate change negotiator for the G77 in Africa. It was Lumumba that collapsed the climate talks in Copenhagen back about 2009. So I had some amazing people, right? Now, when we arrived, Yale, the host said to us, we've educated three of the last four presidents and we're going to educate another one. They've only got 5,000 undergrads. Mm. I thought, wow, what intentionality. And Bush's and Clinton's went to Yale, right? Intentionality of a small university. Now, obviously, there's a lot of selectivity at the front end. But we came back saying, well, what if we had that kind of intention? But what you find is that the university that I saw was everything they did was about growing leaders on purpose. You're not just born a leader. You're given a whole set of circumstances, investments. So by the time you leave, you think you can go and work anywhere. So they go off to the World Bank. They go off to the White House. And proactively giving people that mindset and sense of connectivity and confidence. And importantly, they do give them the connections. Makes a difference. So leadership can only be done on purpose. It's one of the things I do really respect UE's position, actually. UE has set out to be an inclusive university. I don't know if that's the words they'd use, but it has a phenomenal record of bringing people from a wider range of backgrounds into higher education, right, and giving them that platform. And I think that's a real source of city pride for me. And Steve's been on the front end of that. So that the intentionality is of developing leadership is something I've really brought back.
Yeah, I love that word, intentionality. I think I'm going to start using that more. And I think, I think a lot of students, particularly students of colour, have that, something that limits them. They have a limiting belief. They have, and they often deselect themselves. And I was really guilty of that in my first year of uni. An opportunity came up to apply for a scholarship that was it's organised by Freshfields, a big corporate law firm, in memory of Stephen Lawrence. And I almost didn't apply. And I can see my dad's one of the people here, but I told my mum I didn't want to apply. And within 5 minutes, my dad was on the phone, basically crying down the phone and saying, look, you need to apply for this. Yeah. You might not think you're the right fit, but let other people tell you you're not the right person to this.
Yeah, your dad did the right thing.
Yeah.
Your dad's given you wisdom. Like,
definitely.
And you're lucky to have got that. I didn't get that, and I want my children to have it. So let me tell you something about me, right? Your dad did for you what was done for me with Yale. I went into work at the National Health Service. I was lost in life. My director of public health, Hugh Annette, at the time, said to me, hey, Marvin, there's a program at Yale University. I think they'd really like you, right? I went online, I looked at the program. I said, I said, this program ain't never going to apply me. But I tell you what I learned at a young age. Make them reject you, right?
Yeah.
So I thought, all right, well, I'll just put in for it. I'm a mid-level manager in the National Health Service. All I can do is tell them who I am and tell my truth. They offered me a place on it. I turn up, and then you get what you feel is imposter syndrome, right? But I'll tell you something else about it, that you do realize that there is another group of people out there who are just bred to lead. And you see it in the country at the moment. Mm-hmm. People whose confidence has outstripped their competence, right? Now, the problem is Black people, and particularly women as well, self-censor, right? Because there is a model of leadership and it doesn't look like us, right? And then we cannot help but take that on, right? That's the nature of institutional racism. It's out there and we take it on and we self-censor. But, you know, my constant push is not to do that. You push and you push and push. And have aspiration. And you know what? I just say to people, if you're going to have aspiration, buckle up. Get used to the idea of failing. Because if you aspire to do something, by definition, it's going to be bigger than you. And you're going to fail. Mm. But you just got to suck that up and crack on. Right? And you know the great stories of history of people that failed and failed and failed and tried again. But you've just got to crack on. And hopefully it will turn out. It doesn't always turn out fair. This ain't some Ricky Lake world in which if you do your best and, you know, you work hard enough and you got talent and you deserve it, you get it. Sometimes people don't get what they deserve. That's the nature of an unjust world. but give yourself every possible chance. Don't hurt yourself before the world hurts you.
Exactly. And I you talk about failure, and I think we learn the most from the mistakes and failures that we have. And I think that leads us nicely onto the next question, which is about Bristol and Bristol's history. So we all know that Bristol is steeped in racism and colonialism, but I would argue that the city does quite a good job of masking that ugly past. How do you think that Bristol should raise awareness and educate residents and visitors to its past? And how would you challenge the people who say we should just move on?
Well, let me do the move on bit first.
You probably hear that a lot.
because I just don't think people understand what they mean by doing education in history. Like, it's like David Olusoga said, this ain't about guilt. I've got a white mum. I'm not going to go home and say to my white mum, right, let's have a talk about race and I want you to feel guilty about it, right? This is just about doing good quality history. If you're trying to tell the story of Bristol and you don't talk about ships and ports and tobacco and sugar and banking, insurance and triangular trade, you're just not doing good history. It's just your lecturer wouldn't give you a grade because you haven't done the full story. That's all that needs to happen. It's not about guilt. If people start to feel guilty in response to that, then there's another conversation. But it's just about doing good history. I can't emphasize it enough. I think when people talk about move on, again, what do you mean by that? Should we forget the Magna Carta? You know, should we just, again, how do you move on? You're trying to understand who we are. You can't understand who we are unless you understand how we became who we are. So again, doing good history is not failing to move on. It's developing a proper understanding of who we are. What are all those forces and processes that turned us into the city we are? Now, if you fail to understand the forces and processes that turns you into what you've got, which is a city of phenomenal aspiration, but 25% of kids living in poverty, a degree of racial fracture, then how are you going to solve those challenges going into the future if you don't know what created them? I mean, it's you're just aiming to be stupid, collective stupidity. So you can't afford to do that. Now, there's another subtle question there that goes around awareness, right? And I think some black people are falling to this trap too, is in that they want everyone to be aware, right? I think we should do good history, but is my first port of call white awareness? It's not really. I think that too often, and I get some of the, to be honest, there's a bit of a political debate at the moment in the city where people are saying, oh, you should invest in, do this about culture and all that. Look, we don't dance our way to freedom or drum our way to political equality. Racism isn't about awareness. Racism is about power. Racism is about economics. It was a system of distributing wealth and power. The solution to racism is the redistribution of wealth and power, right? Now, that's not necessarily done through raising awareness, right? Awareness is part of it, but there are other paths. But I think we end up using up the whole bandwidth of our challenge on racism to I want you to be aware of my situation. I just think just for black and brown people to get on with the business of aspiring to positions of power and building wealth actually need more energy and potentially are more important. You go on YouTube, I mean, you read Malcolm X, Martin Luther King and all that, but go on YouTube and watch the documentary about Black Wall Street. That was a segregated black community. Just leave us. I know an American friend of mine said to me a few years ago, I don't vote Democrat because they'll do anything for me. They know they won't do anything to me. Now, at the time, I thought that was cynical. When you watch the Black Wall Street documentary, you see what that means. Just leave black people alone. They'll build wealth, right? They'll get on with it, right? They don't need awareness amongst wider white America. They just need to be left to do their thing. So it's a subtle argument. Do you know what I mean? But it's really important. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think kind of following up with that, we this summer we've also seen kind of a lot of what I would describe as performative statements made by big organizations, big brands around the world. How helpful are those, and what should be done instead by those people with the power to make change?
So there's two things I say about statements, right? there's a friend of mine, he used a phrase I really liked. He said occupy the rhetoric. You know, when someone makes a statement, you know, there is a door, no matter how small, that you can walk into to occupy that space and begin to say, okay, well, you made this statement, you don't know how to do it, let me help you understand how to deliver on that statement that you're making. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we need to be very careful that the statements don't become symbolic acts that replace substantial change, right? But let me bring that back to Colston's statue. There's a danger of that with the Colston statue, right? So the danger is, at the moment with the Colston statue, and I was asked, well, why didn't you, let me put it this way. I was asked, well, why didn't you take down a statue? Well, I said a number of things about that. First off, you wait for hundreds of years for a black leader to come along, suddenly Colston statue is his fault. How does that work, right? Mm-hmm. So my fault now, Colston ain't down, right? Secondly, I was elected in the middle of Brexit. So first black mayor makes the top priority of taking down Colston statue, which is synonymous with Bristol's identity, in the middle of a Brexit debate. What do you think I'd have spent the next 4 years talking about, right?
Oh, good.
Nothing, not housing, not employment, yeah. Not trade, not winning Channel 4, not transport solutions, not air quality, mm-hmm. climate, ecology. I would have just been talking about Colston, that's all. So that would have been, that's naive. Mm. But thirdly, I said to a number of people, if I went with my pledge list to Bristol to tackle racism, and I got 5 spaces on that list, and taking down Colston's statue is on that list, a smart person would say, really? What is that actually going to change? Mm. Now, we have two truths at the same time here. The statue is symbolically significant and sends a message, right? So it is significant. But the drivers of racism are around wealth, inequality in education, criminal justice system, housing access, disproportionate levels of unemployment. Where does removing a statue fit on those top 5 lists of tackling racism within the city? So we've got to be very careful that not only do businesses sell us short with symbolic acts, but we as a community also don't engage in symbolic acts that fill the emotional void but don't actually produce substantial change in our position within the political economic order.
Yeah, and I think we're seeing that a lot with, like yesterday it was announced that there were going to be 4 new post boxes painted black for Black History Month. Or earlier this year we've heard about kind of episodes of Little Britain being taken down. I can accept that. That is offensive, but that's not what black people are calling for. That's a way of hijacking the conversation and creating this sort of I want to use the word binary, because that was one of the responses you had for Christian Guru Murthy when you were interviewed by him on the day that the statue came down. We're stuck between, often missing the point, because you have to be on one side of the conversation, debate or the other, and we lose the kind of how nuanced these discussions are. In terms of Colston and that coming down, to what extent did the global interest in Bristol add pressure to your role? Like, we saw that it kind of had this domino effect. But we also saw, it was mentioned by Reverend Al Sharpton at George Floyd's funeral. It was tweeted by Ice Cube. In those kind of days and weeks that followed, how did you feel? What pressure was added to your role?
I tell you what, right? Here's another thing that goes back to the point you made earlier on about not putting yourself forward for things. Mm. And this has been my experience of being mayor. When you have aspiration, you step into a new space, you will have imposter syndrome, right? Because you shouldn't be there. And what happens is you walk around for a while thinking, oh, it's very self-conscious, thinking everyone else should be here and you shouldn't. Mm. And then you face trials. This is the other thing about suffering. And I use a proverb a lot. Suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. So you, and as you go into that space, you face these trials and they're incredibly hard work. And then one day what you find is you no longer feel like an imposter, and you don't know what that day is. But one day you think, actually, so when I was first elected, I used to go places and people introducing me as the mayor. And I never used to call myself the mayor. And then one day I said, yeah, I'm the mayor of Bristol. I never know when that moment came. So I say that as a general piece of insight experience in my life, right? That you will hopefully experience yourselves. You'll get that imposter syndrome, and then you'll realize. So actually, that fits in that as that moment came, it didn't bother me, right? Mm. Because I was the mayor of Bristol, and that was my job. The other thing that I think gives you an incredible source of strength and power is if you're just telling the truth. And that doesn't mean I have access to truth that other people don't, but I wasn't like fibbing or trying to blend or nuance. I was just saying what I thought. So I just said the same thing over and over again, right? I can't condone criminal damage. Of course I can't, right? But am I glad the statue's gone down? Yes, I am. Did I think it was a beautiful piece of historical poetry? Yes, I did. And I've got caught in a world in which two things are true at the same time that are quite difficult to hold together as bedfellows. But do you know what? That's the adult world.
Yeah. We
live with contradictions.
Yeah.
That's the way it is. And I just sat behind my desk, did I don't know how many interviews, but spoke to literally 250 million people in TV interviews, about 450 million if you do print journalism as well, and didn't think about it. Not because I think I'm anything special, but your trials in your history prepare you for that moment. Can I just say one other thing? Because it's just important for us coming from our backgrounds, right? There's a fantastic bit at the beginning of the film, Good Will Hunting. It's the Harvard bar scene. It's worth watching, right? When this poor kid is in a bar with all these Harvard students, and he says to one of the students, you dropped 250 grand on education you could have got for $1.50 in late charges at the public library. Listen, when you come from a background of trial, and you sit at that top table with people who should be there, you've done more than them. You've gone further than them, you know? When I sit at the table with George Soros did come a long way, but when I sit at the table with lots of mayors who went to Harvard and went to the private schools, and I went to St. George City Academy, and I'm there, pound for pound, skill for skill, hour for hour, who's done the biggest journey? Who's shown the most resolve and the most resilience? I say this to kids on our leadership program, right? And you should see that as your source of pride, not as a liability that you didn't go to the right school, right? Yeah. That is a source of pride. You've come further, you've done more, you've been stronger, you've been more resilient, and you're there. Now you're at the same table.
Yeah, you've got there's some gems of advice in here. You speak about trials, you speak about kind of pressure, being hopeful, being true to yourself. I think those are things that I can really resonate. They really resonate with me. And there have been times when I've really suffered with imposter syndrome, being that in my current role now as an assistant lecturer, where I look around the department and I don't see many people of color, I don't see any black men in my department, unless they're hiding in the covers. But I have to find that strength in myself. And also, I think a big part of this is about not pulling the ladder up from underneath me. People have put open doors for me, and I'm so grateful. But I'd be the biggest traitor to myself if I just shut those doors in other people's faces and kept that treasure almost for myself. I think that it's so important that we kind of lift each other up as we go up too.
I see Roger Griffin posting on this because we used to live together down back in the same block in Weston. He lived upstairs from my flat.
Yeah, I spoke to him this morning in preparation. Thank you, Roger, for your help and advice this morning. My last question about Colston before we move on. What will happen to that empty space now where Colston once stood?
So we're going to leave it empty for a while. But I'm going to tell you something about the Mark Quinn statue as well, which needs to come across. So look, first of all, the empty plinth, I don't think is a problem. Why we rush to do something, right? An empty plinth is symbolic of where we are as a city and a world at the moment, right? We're looking for answers. We don't know what they are. So let's give the city a chance to breathe, a little bit of space, right? And let me tell you something else. Historically, the Colston statue wasn't put up by the people of Bristol. The Colston statue was put up by a rich Bristolian who couldn't get any money from the people of Bristol. Right? One person and his little cadre decided to put that statue up, Arrowsmith, right? Why should a aristocratic white sculptor from London decide what goes on that plinth? That's not about Jen Reed. Again, there's a subtle but a significant distinction to be made here. Mm-hmm. That's not about Jen Reed. I recognize that. But that wasn't, it was put up by a privilege. And in fact, I talked to black sculptors. I had a little conversation the other day. And there's no track record of that in supporting black artists, even though he's phenomenally successful and rich. Just mm-hmm. turns up, world's on stage. Here's my art, everybody. I was quite annoyed by that. And we talked about as soon as the Colston statue came up, he got in touch with Bristol Council and said he wanted to talk to me. I talked to him. He said, I've got this sculpture, I've got this idea. And I said, hold on there. Thanks for the offer. It's really appreciative and the spirit is great. But I said, could you just hold on? The city is a very tense at the moment. We need space to breathe, right? Mm-hmm. What to you is a metropolitan, rich, white Londoner is a debate could turn into a race attack on an isolated black family in Bristol, right? And we need the city to have the chance to decide what goes on that plinth. Then I get a text one morning and he texts me saying, Marvin, I've just put the statue up. Even though I said, look, I think there's a risk that you could stoke up racial tensions. Alex mm-hmm. Rakes from Sorry will tell you that once that mm-hmm. statue went up, there was an increase in the number of race reported incidents within the city. It's all right having your cheese and wine down in London. I've had less and less patience with him, even though I tried to be gracious in the first instance, because of the arrogance and the arrogance of his response ever since. Show me a track record of supporting black artists and I believe you're real about it. Show me what you've done historically. Otherwise, I could draw the conclusion, I'm not making an accusation, that you saw a global platform to put your art on display, mm-hmm. to develop your notoriety, which has pound signs to your work.
Yeah, and it was convenient.
You're gaming racism. Mm. Again, taking advantage of black bodies for your own financial gain.
Yeah, I listened to a podcast earlier about that, very exactly what you're talking about, and the question, the main kind of question or takeaway was, who did that statue benefit? The replacement. And like you summarized really well, I don't think it did benefit black people in the city. We've got about 10 minutes left before we move to a Q&A. I've got a few questions, just some short questions we can get through quite quickly. So in terms of this conversation about race, what's the most surprising fact that you know about Bristol, one that some of the viewers might not know very well, much about?
A surprising fact about the city?
Yeah.
Oh, I always just share people that about 25% of our kids are growing up in poverty. Because I think, yeah, the story to the outside world is of a thriving city, two world-class universities, thriving creative sector, PhDs galore, and yet 25% of our kids are in poverty. Over 20% of our kids are at risk of hunger every day.
Mm. Yeah. My one links back to my fact. I did some research, links back to the... I've got two, actually. I'll be quick. One would be about this university, about UWE, and the fact that it was, lots of people don't know that it was started, the university started as, or origins date back to 1595 and the Merchant Venturers Navigation School. And the other one, a more positive one, is that synergy between the end of the Bristol bus boycott being on exactly the same day as probably the most famous speech ever, Martin Luther King's I Had a Dream speech. So that was 28th of August, 1963. You touched on poverty just then, and this next question kind of links to that. Gentrification is changing cities, and the cultures and the racial profiles of cities across the world. You could, can you comment on the impact that gentrification is having in Bristol?
Yeah, I can. And look, I'm sitting in Easton. I'm on board with Easton for £16,000. Mm. I mean, you can get a house for less than £300,000 in Easton now. So yeah, it's frightening. It's gentrification is a well-worn path now, and it practically what you end up is. When the economic activity is in the middle of Bristol, those people who've lived in the city be pushed away from economic activity. Cost of living increases on transport anyway. You get a compounding of inequality because they've missed out on like Piketty economics, right? Which is if you own stuff, you get richer rather than deserving your way out of it. So you miss out. Are my children being too loud in the background? I hope not.
No, I can't hear them.
They're bashing around the house here. And and then you get resentment. And I, to be honest, I feel that resentment in me when I think about people just making money out of, and in fact, they're making money out of deprivation in many ways, because one of the things that's driven the house prices down is the historical deprivation and poverty.
Yeah.
Buy them, and then they make money from the improvements, and you know, it's a painful process. Mayors all over the world, I will say, are grappling with gentrification. I'm friends with, very close friends with Steve Benjamin, who's the first African American mayor in Columbus, South Carolina. He was former president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors. Mayor Garcetti in Los Angeles were close to. Loads of mayors are grappling with gentrification. It's an ongoing challenge for us.
Yeah, it's a huge issue, and I think being from Southeast London, from Forest Hill in Lewisham, every time I go home, and I'm going home later this evening, getting the train after this, it's so different. I don't feel the environment has changed completely. I see fewer faces that look like me. I see fewer shops that that are marketed towards people like me. Primary schools, my primary school was incredibly mixed, and I talk to my neighbours now and they say that their black child is the only black child in their class, whereas I was one of 20 out of 30. It's a real shame.
Can I just share another dynamic for me with gentrification? So interestingly, having shared a bit about my story, which is kind of an interesting about the lack of awareness of kind of white woke people, or some of the biggest campaigners against gentrification who come to moan at me about what am I doing about this, that and the other, are the gentrifiers. You know? So, and I say, you really, but they're really angry about it. But what happens is they have a great profile because they're really astute on social media. They have the wherewithal to start up their own print, like Bristol Cable and so forth. You know, so, you know, they are the biggest. And then actually I get some of my kind of biggest kind of anti-capitalist protesters from people who actually I grew up seeing as quite posh. And I will share with you, I went to an Extinction Rebellion event at Malcolm X Center a little while ago. There's like 150 people there in Malcolm X in St. Paul's, and you know, it's anti-establishment and all that. And I agree with, I think they've got access to truth. But if we're honest about it, they come up to me and said, well, what do you think of the event? And I said, do you want me to tell the truth? I said, yeah. I said, well, there were 150 people there, three in the room aren't white, and I'm one of them. And you're in St. Paul's, what's that about?
Yeah, yeah.
But I said, I also said, well, how are you holding me accountable for this new liberal order? Your people built it. It was built by rich white Europeans, not Africans.
Not poor
white people that I come from. Your people built it. So now turning up, after I've just happened to get elected, and holding me accountable for this global neoliberal order that you want to pull apart, that you benefited from with your private school, I said, you can understand there's a little bit of dynamic in that, can't you?
Yeah, definitely. I interestingly enough, when I finished university, I moved back home to London, and I had a similar experience to, like you're saying, you had in St. Paul's, where I joined a Labour Party, would go to meetings, and I'm sat in a room in Southeast London, and I'm the only black face there. And the first meeting I went to, they said, oh, we need a new BAME officer. No, the first they said, we need a new youth officer. And the whole room looked at me because I'm the youngest person in the room. And I'm like, no. And the secondly was, we need a new BAME officer. And again, the whole room looked, and I said, I didn't say anything, but I wanted to say, can't you see that this is a big problem? Look at where we are. Look at the community we're meant to be serving. I think getting political engagement is so important, and in making atmospheres that are welcoming. And to be fair, at that Labour branch, there were the secretary did a great job of kind of, anytime I put my hand up, she would call on me and dismiss the queue of people. And that was really helpful. It helped me to kind of grow in confidence in that space. We're kind of coming towards the end of this bit of the event. And I think I want to close with a question. So I watched your film last night, the Mayor's Race film, in preparation for this. And I really liked the way it ended. And you finished with a quote that said, I hope that the city makes life better for people like my mum. There can be hope in the middle of all this crap, is your final line. So what are your hopes for the near future, and what are you hopeful about in Bristol? That can be in your life, in terms of your career, in terms of the city. Interpret it at your own will.
Yeah, I mean, if I say it, it almost sounds like apple pie when I say it, you know. I want Bristol to be a city in which the circumstances of your birth don't determine your life chances.
Mm.
You know, that to me, that's the ultimate injustice. And we know that to be the case. We're one of the most socially immobile countries in the OECD. That's a phenomenal injustice, that before your talent, ability, hard work, it's your circumstances of your birth that determine whether you're going to die poor or die and die early. Or get sick early and live a life of long-term illness. Quite apart from that, it's not an efficient way to run your country. You know, we're leaving millions of pounds worth of talent on the shelf every year, undeveloped. So that's my hope, really. I've started to define it in terms of social mobility. If I can just add another one in there, that as we do this, that we don't kill the planet. climate change and ecological emergency, right? We got species going extinct left, right, and center. We urgently need to unlock a new world way of running the world. And, you know, I mean, we can talk another time about that, but I just think that we have a bit of a crisis of governance at the moment, and we have the turgid model of global governance that's built around a nation state. It's just that it was great in the 1950s, but it's not great for 2020. We need cities to be have much more purchase on the world stage, shaping policy. On everything, from climate to migration,
and time's running out, and time and patience is running short. I think, and I think that kind of brings a nice end to this bit of just the conversation, because ultimately, this year and has been really difficult and for a lot of people, but we move, we keep going, we keep persevering, we have hope. All those kind of keywords that you mentioned earlier.
Keep on keeping on. That's
literally. Cool. Thanks so much. It's been a pleasure to talk to you, and I look forward to meeting you in person soon, hopefully.
Yeah. Listen, I'm available in this Zoom world. Whatever I can do to support, let me know. Yeah.
Thank you. Louise, is I'm going to pass back to you.
Hi everyone. Now we are onto the question side of the event. You will have an opportunity to ask questions for the mayor. I can't reiterate enough so these questions are going to be monitored by the Equality, Diversity and Inclusivity Team. We're on the other side of the system. We may not be able to answer all your questions, but we really thank you for your engagement, and it's been really great to see in the chat kind of everyone talking. If you either on your computers or on your phones, go to menti.com and you'll be able to submit your questions to us, and they will appear on our side, the questions, and we'll be able to select the questions, and it will make them appear to you on the screen. Just as a reminder, the University of UE Bristol has a zero tolerance on bullying and harassment. Therefore, we ask that you are kind and respectful in what questions you ask, how you ask them, and ensure that they are relevant to tonight's conversation. And we reserve the right to accept or decline questions as well. So I'll give you a few minutes to start off with, and once this question start coming in, then you'll be able to ask questions. Bear with us a second in terms of the Mentimeter code. 2 seconds. Bear with us. So you should see on the screen for the Mentimeter code. So if you type that in, and then we'll be able to see the questions on the other side. Thank you.
In the meantime, Marvin, I was just going to ask, I can hear your kids now. I couldn't hear them before, but how have you managed all that, like homeschooling and stuff like that? How's that been for you?
Homeschooling's a challenge. It's a challenge for everyone.
I think working from home as well. I think I haven't been back to the university since March. So I think it's just about trying to find that balance and sort of work invade. I'd like to try and keep work and social life quite separate, but suddenly they were mashed together, and it's difficult to find that separation and make sure that I'm not overworking myself, that I'm also kind of relaxing and enjoying. And that was quite difficult, especially with the stressful marking periods and stuff, but I think we got through it in the end. And hopefully, I mean, the other thing I would just say is that I really hope that the city makes a kind of a full recovery from COVID. I think especially the hospitality sector in particular, Bristol's kind of world famous for its nights out.
It's going to be a challenge.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a challenge. I think
big challenge.
Make sure hopefully the government stump up some cash to support get the financial stimulation that they need.
The truth is, we're heading into probably one of the biggest economic depressions in centuries, and it's going to be brutal. Our challenge, and working with people like Steve as well, is to anticipate what those challenges are and try and preempt them so we can minimise the harm. But there is going to be harm. People are going to lose their jobs and people will lose their homes. We've got to prepare ourselves for that and try and support them through it.
Yeah.
Okay, everyone, we are going to start sharing the questions with you. We may have to do it through an alternative format just because if you just hold on a second, this is the beauty of like online things, because I'm just in essence of time and in essence of just making this all works smoothly. So apologies, everyone. I'm gonna type them in. I'm gonna put them in the chat, and then we can answer them this way.
So, first question I can see for Marvin: how do we get communities in Bristol to work together and share their cultures, experiences, and perspectives, rather than the postcode segregation we sometimes have?
Oh gosh, getting communities to work together. We've done that on purpose. Maybe that's an obvious thing to say. It's one thing, you have to do it on purpose, because it doesn't happen by accident just because we're nice people. We have to create the space for people to do it. So I think clearly there's something about creating a shared vision, which is something that we've tried to do through the Bristol One City Plan. So what do we actually want to be as Bristol, and how do we think we're going to get there? It's been massively important to us. So if I look at someone around food and hunger, for example, we've actually brought communities together to tackle that. Sorry, I just recognize my phone is really low on power, and I'm wondering if I can switch it to my iPad, which is also on but doesn't seem to be offering me a camera option for some reason. Allow me just to get my charger. Sorry, just one.
That's fine. That's fine.
Okay, we're plugged in. Cool. Sorry about that.
It's all right.
And then we need good people who are going to be intentional about violating those boundaries. It does take proactivity on behalf of organisers to go across some of those historical boundaries, particularly of race and class, and reach out. I tell you, Mohammed Al-Sharif has done stuff like this. He's one of our community development workers. He was in my team in the health service as well when I was in public health. The Muslims for Bristol, doing the Grand Iftar, but also taking up street cleaning teams up to places like Hartcliffe. It's been amazing to see.
Great. That next question is, if Bristol has any lessons for other cities around the world after our moment in the global eye, what are they?
Oh, gosh. I think we just have to be right. What I would say is don't categorize people too easily. Right. So let me tell you something. I obviously we had the Black Lives Matter rally. The weekend after, there was the Cenotaph rally, right, with football fans and the Hells Angels. Now, some people easily categorised that Cenotaph rally as far right, and it wasn't far right. There may have been some far right people there, but it wasn't a far right event. And I actually went to meet some of those people, even though some of them were demonised and all that. I went to meet some of them and talk to them. And actually, I said, well, what is going on for you? Well, first off, we had a long chat and they would talk about race. They were at pains to point out they weren't opposed to Black Lives Matter, but they were concerned about the safety of the cenotaph. They talked a lot about class. And then I said to the guy, so what's going on for you? And he said, we just feel like we're losing our city. And I said, you are losing your city, but you're losing it to house prices. That process of gentrification is a very powerful process. It's not just in the inner city. It's on some of our housing estates where historically white working class people were moved after the slum clearances, Bedminster, Lot Lees and so forth. And we have to listen to people and hear, even if we disagree with their conclusions, you have to listen to people and find out why they think what they think without just demonizing them. I'll tell you something else that's interesting. One of the organizers who I went to meet, when his wife brought me in a cup of tea, he's a white guy, she was black, right? And I heard there was a guy saying, don't call me far right, as my wife won't be happy. And he's in an interracial marriage. And as I was about to leave, he got his phone out and he said, oh, I just want to show you something. And he handed his phone to me. And there was a picture of me on his phone with his wife just after I'd got elected. So this guy that was being castigated as far right carries a picture of this black mare around on his phone for a fortnight. Right. It's not that simple. Right. And we've got to be careful to be able to live with difference and understand difference and appreciate that just because you don't agree with someone's conclusion, it doesn't mean that they don't have a number of premises in their argument that actually stand up. Right. And we've got to respect some of those and work with them on maybe coming to a different conclusion if we don't agree with that.
Great answer. The next question is, Marvin, you said this evening that black people should aim for positions of power. Is there any area in particular that you believe our contributions would be most valuable at this time?
So I think we need to get people I just list them, right? We need people in law, the criminal justice system. So Angela Goley, I think, is a barrister, the only Asian barrister in the Southwest. We need more black lawyers and barristers. And then we need them to become judges. Peter Blair, who's a city recorder, who's a good guy. He's the judge. He's a white guy. But he is really doing some great work about trying to encourage more black and Asian people to become barristers. I actually was on a Zoom call with him and Anjali just a few weeks ago. We had about 40 black and Asian solicitors and barristers, people at various stages in their career, who were thinking about becoming barristers, and he was really encouraging them and supporting them in the process. Criminal justice, politics were needed. Politics is the most accessible because you can just get voted in and you don't necessarily need $1 million. We need people rising up through the ranks of business. So get on those executive schemes, get your MBA, and get up there. And urgently, we need them in journalism. I think this is a dangerous thing for me to say, but I worked at the BBC. I understand that the new director general of the BBC has just said there's no institutional racism in the BBC, which is very dangerous. But I find journalism really impoverished in Bristol. It's just cheap. And I will say, I will share with you, right, the Bristol Post did a sose expose on racism in the council. I'm not denying there's racism in the council, but in the last 50 years, how many black people have they employed as a local paper? And the local papers are often the gateway to national journalistic positions.
Mm.
You know, that kind of the lack of self-awareness is frightening amongst. And what I get is, well, you're a politician. You don't have any right to challenge a journalist. I said the other day, I'm still a black guy, you know, dealing with a racist media. Why being interviewed by quite posh, thank you very much, privileged people, you know, and people lose that context. That you just look at the Twitter feed yesterday when I told a journalist this question was silly. You know, somehow I'm the oppressor. It's really weird. But we urgently need people, because most people don't interact with the world and journalism. They interact with politicians. They interact with the journalistic interpretation of politics. And let me tell you one other thing about that that's really dangerous. There's a game that goes on in journalism that all politics is crap, right? Andrew Marr does it with his Oxbridge background, and you know, and all the others do it. Now, who are the first people to withdraw from politics when they think it's a waste of time? It's the most marginalized, right? It's the poorest, it's the working classes, and we hear it in our own communities. Who most needs politics to work for them? Our people, right? Look at what Trump just did. This come on Channel 4 News, that voter suppression, trying to convince black people not to vote. And yet every day we have this kind of middle class, chattering class game on our political commentary on journalism that, oh, well, all you politicians, you're having spats, it's all the same. And they don't realize the price our communities pay when they don't get involved in politics, because they think all you politicians are the same. They don't have to worry about it because of their race and class status. They don't even need to say anything because the system works for them. Yeah. But we need to force the system to work for us by being in positions of power. So I think it's a real blind spot in our media that we need our people to get on top of.
Definitely.
And by our people, I mean black and brown people, but I mean working class people too.
Definitely. I'll keep these questions coming. We've got a few minutes left. What advice, just quite a pertinent one, what advice would you give to a new black student starting university this forthcoming term in a field that's predominantly or dominated by white people and white students?
So watch Good Will Hunting, one of my favorite films. I tell you, I really like the film. But go back, I said to my friend, one of my best friends from university, Nigerian guy, and we were chatting, and I said to him, I said, oh, I wish I knew then what I know now. That point I made earlier, if you are at the same place as them, you have come further, you've shown more resilience, and you've got to take pride in that. You know, that's got to become your source of power. So that sense that you're the only one, don't see that as a source of I don't see that as a liability, a source of weakness. See it as a source of power.
Yeah,
that you've proven so much.
Yeah, and I think there's so much strength in being the only one. That makes you unique. It means you're different. You can stand out easier. And for me, there've been so many times where I've kind of had to navigate incredibly white spaces, whether that's on work experience or at times even in my role now. But yeah, like you're saying, I have to use that difference to my advantage and being able to offer a different spin, that's what the beauty of diversity is. It's about being able to have a different perspective. And diversity is about the diversity of thought. It's not always about the diversity of color.
Can I just say as well, and in that situation, don't feel that it's your job to hold up the issue of race equality every day. This is a long game. You know, there's a proverb says, be wise as serpents, innocent as doves. But you've got to be wise. It's a long game. If every day you walk into a room, you think you have to say something about race, you're going to wear out your currency. Just be you, right? And sometimes just being you is enough, because you're there. Everyone can tell, right? And I say this too in our community, because sometimes in our community, the politics is a little bit naive. Just because you've got to play an ace in your pack doesn't mean you have to play it in the next hand. You got to play your ace at the right time, in the right combination.
Yeah.
Not just because you've got it, you know? And you play your cards at the right time.
And that's something else. Is when you have a singular black person or singular person of color in a space, they suddenly become or there's that pressure to feel like you're a representative of everyone else, and you're, but actually Black people are not, or people of color are not a homogenous group. My experience is, and identity is completely different to my neighbors, and it's quite different to my brother's experiences, and it's quite different to a woman who grows up as an in the north of England, and it's quite different to a Bristolian. We're all different, we're all unique, and that should be kind of respected at all times. Last couple of questions. Where do you see Yui being able to...
I'd say a point that Roger made, which I think is a really, as a really in the chat, which is about Bristol Cable 24/7 and mm-hmm. Lawrence appearing for opportunities for stories. I agree with Roger, and I love Roger on a lot of points, but the point I think I'm making, diversity in the media, it's not that our media start to tell stories about Black people that makes them open. It's when we have the editorships and the when we're getting the pensions and the wages from those organizations, that's when they're making change. Otherwise, we just become news fodder. And I think actually in our community sometime, our people are while we complain about, you know, we get a lot of validation from institutions that actually don't give Black people and Asian people jobs. So I'm in the paper. Oh, fantastic. Look at that, you're in the paper. Well, that's small fry. You know, when I was on Radio Bristol, I could give you 3 minutes on the radio without a second thought about it. But that doesn't mean that you got a job at the BBC with the BBC pension. You know, it doesn't mean that you're making decisions about what is commissioned and so forth. So we have to be careful about being given small prizes, you know, selling ourselves cheap. Getting some media coverage does not mean that the media is changing. It just means that they're featuring us because we're material.
Or topical, it's current, it's yeah, relevant. I'm being kind of told that this is the end now. I'd really like to say, on behalf of Yui, thank you so much for your time this evening. It feels like, based on the comments, people think we've had a great chat. So, and I've really enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you for having me. Appreciate you.
Take care.
Thank you again, everyone. Hi, I'm Louise. I'm from the Equality Best Inclusivity Team. Marvin, you've been absolutely amazing. We are trying very hard to stick to time so you can leave on time for your next engagement. But we just really appreciate you for taking the time for today. To everyone in the room, please take the time to complete the survey that has been put in the chat, because we really need and value your feedback. And keep an eye out on the rest of the Black History Month events that you can find on the UE events and selecting Black History Month or Twitter page. But I really hope that you've all enjoyed tonight. It's been a pleasure being able to facilitate this conversation. Xavier, you've been amazing. Marvin, again, you've been amazing. And thank you so much to both Professor Steve West and Professor Paul Lemonnier for joining us at the beginning as the executive leads of the university to kind of really set the tone and scene of tonight. So on that note,
I'm gonna be a lot of trouble with the journalists now, I think.
No, you've been beautifully authentic, and it's been amazing.
Watch Twitter go mad now about being a politician criticizing the journalists. It's very sensitive.
But thank you so much, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your evenings. Marvin, thank you again, and we will see you for the rest of the Black History Month events here at UE Bristol. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.